Ladies and gentlemen, in the previous video we addressed how optimally wind and photovoltaic solar can be sized within a microgrid. During this video we address how these different components can be connected together to form a microgrid. The main learning objectives will fall under three main questions. Firstly, how can a microgrid be connected to an external upstream grid? Secondly, what are the possible layouts for microgrids? And thirdly, what are the main differences between these layouts? The figure shows a simplified scheme of a microgrid which consists of distributed generators, loads and energy storage. Some of the generators are based on renewable energy sources. This means that the amount of the generated power cannot be accurately controlled since it depends on uncontrollable factors like the weather, wind and solar, sun conditions. Energy storage devices can improve the reliability and efficiency of those generators by storing or by providing the power imbalance between the load's demand and the renewable power source's capability. In addition, it provides the energy requirements for seamless transition between grid-connected and island operation modes. This microgrid is connected to the external upstream network at the point of common coupling, or PCC. The selection of the proper microgrid architecture is a critical issue that must be done carefully since it can seriously affect the economic viability of the project. It is necessary to consider the nature of the loads, the existing and planned distributed generators, the space to place the energy storage devices, the difficulty to place new electrical lines, and the existing communications, among other relevant issues. Thus, for designers, it is very important to have a good knowledge about the strong and weak points of the different technologies, topologies, and layouts of architecture of microgrids. For example, in the common case of existing facilities with AC loads, the most suitable option is probably an AC microgrid, because it needs minimal modifications on the existing installations. However, for new installations, other alternatives, for example DC, with a better performance can be considered. The microgrid can be connected to the upstream network through various electrical components. The most commonly used component is a circuit breaker, which could be either AC or DC. The second is a static switch, which is a semiconductor-based driven switch controlling the microgrid for either grid-connected mode or islanded mode. The typical power semiconductor used for the implementation of a static switch is a triac, like the one shown in the figure, but many other circuits have been proposed in the literature. The triac is the preferred option because it supports large overcurrents, even kiloamps, during some grid cycles. The third is a solid-state transformer, which is a newly developed power electronic device substituting the conventional 50 and 60 Hz transformers employing high-frequency isolated AC-AC converters. Solid-state transformer allows to connect AC grids with a certain frequency to microgrids with a frequency that is different one than the grid's nominal frequency. We discussed importance, the strong and weak points of the different topologies and layouts and architecture of the microgrids. Let us have a look at AC microgrids. AC microgrids involve a transformer and point of common coupling, a static switch, and a lot of converters for loads, generations and storage. In the AC microgrid architecture operated in a grid-connected mode, the power flows directly from the grid, avoiding any serious connected converters. This feature provides a very high reliability. The feeders have the same voltage and frequency conditions as the grid, so that the loads, generators and energy storage devices must be grid compliant. At the same time, more microgrids, feeders, can be connected. It is easy to control the voltage and frequency as a signal to the power quality. Static VAR compensator with the capacitors and inverters can be also implemented. The main disadvantage of this layout is that a large number of complex power converters are required that lead to an increased power losses and decreased in reliability. The AC microgrid is especially suitable for the integration of the microgrid concept into the existing facilities and probably will be the common microgrid architecture in the near future. The DC microgrid is connected through an AC to DC converter to the grid. It is desired that the microgrid can be able to export the excess of its generated power through its bidirectional converters. We will talk later this week about this converter technology. DC microgrids have a relatively higher efficiency if the AC or DC conversion steps can be skipped. Power converters are bidirectional, working in two quadrants, allowing them to revert the current. To achieve two quadrants with current reversal, there is therefore a need for the technology to switch the current to negative while keeping the voltage at the same polarity to have a negative power flow and changing direction. The DC microgrid has a DC bus with a regulated voltage, and most distributed generators need an DC to DC and AC to DC power electronic interfaces to be connected to the bus. The AC loads require a DC-AC converter to adapt the bus voltage to the required conditions. DC loads sometimes can be connected directly to the DC bus or may need a DC-AC converter depending on the bus voltage. To provide fast and stable load steps, some capacitors may be added to the bus without any electronic interface. The voltage of the DC bus is regulated by the main AC to DC converter. When the distribution grid fails, the microgrid must regulate itself, the DC bus voltage, without the main AC to DC converter, and later we will talk about the different control methods. The DC microgrid architecture presents some advantages over the AC microgrid: a reduced number of power converters and more simple DC-DC and DC-AC rectifiers, the possibility to adapt the DC bus voltage to the microgrid requirements, and a very high quality of the DC bus voltage, allowing some DC loads to be connected directly to the DC bus. The main drawback of this architecture is the series connected bidirectional AC to DC converter handling the whole power flow from and to the distribution grid and reducing its reliability. In the DC zonal microgrids, several DC feeders are connected to the main AC bus through centralized bidirectional AC to DC converter. The DC zonal microgrid concept shown in the figure has two different zones which allow to have different DC voltage levels. The goal is to have the highest efficiency while at the same time the lowest possible conversion steps. If the microgrids are operated at 350 volt, then going to 2 volt DC for the LED lights is a large voltage step. Therefore, it is more efficient to divide the microgrid into two zones and simultaneously avoid a step-down converter in between. This architecture provides the same advantages and disadvantages as the DC microgrids, but the DC zonal microgrid allows different DC bus voltages and management techniques at each feeder. The main drawback of this architecture is the increased complexity because of the interconnection between the feeders. The AC to DC hybrid microgrid architecture consists of an AC microgrid with a DC subgrid tied together by a bidirectional AC to DC converter. Distributed generators can be connected to the AC or to the DC feeders. AC loads are connected to the AC feeder, whereas DC loads are connected to the DC feeder using a power converter to adapt the voltage level if it is necessary. The DC subgrid can act as a generator or a load of the AC microgrid depending on the power balance at the DC feeder. This architecture combines the advantages of AC and DC microgrids. There is a direct connection to the grid, this presenting a very high reliability. The AC feeder allows using the existing equipment. The DC feeder allows the use of a reduced number of simple converters. Moreover, some DC loads can be connected directly to the DC feeder without the need of any power converter. This microgrid architecture is suitable for installation with critical loads at the DC feeder in combination with more robust loads at the AC feeder. Solid-state transformers can also be used to form a hybrid microgrid. Solid-state transformer-based microgrids simultaneously supply both AC and DC feeders. Thanks to the solid-state transformer, many AC or DC conversion steps can be eliminated. However, as the solid-state transformer is connected in series through DC-DC and AC-DC converters, the reliability is reduced. In this video, we introduced components which are used to connect a microgrid to an external grid. The most widely used is a circuit breaker, while the solid-state transformer can be used to create a more advanced hybrid layouts. Also, we introduced several commonly known possible layouts for microgrids, namely AC, DC, DC zonal, and solid-state transformer-based ones. Through so far, most of the projects on microgrids have been using mainly AC. Due to the many advantages of DC, it is expected that DC microgrids would be widely deployed in the near future. Question often asked is, what is the best layout and architecture of a microgrid? Let's try to answer this question in the next video.